What's up, shelf addicts? Welcome back to the Shelf Addiction Podcast. Today on Book Chat, we are continuing our reread of the Mercy Thompson series written by Patricia Briggs. This episode, we are diving into Book 2, Bloodbound. Stay tuned. Today's episode is sponsored in part by audiobooks.com. Audiobooks.com now has 175,000 titles and 1.2 million podcasts. New customers get 3 free audiobooks comprised of 1 premium credit and 2 VIP titles. Use our promo code SHELFADDICTION, spelled as one word, when you sign up at audiobooks.com. Again, our promo code is SHELFADDICTION. Hey everyone, I'm your host, Tamara Ford, and welcome to Book Chat here on the Shelf Addiction Podcast. Participate in this discussion by joining the Facebook group, Shelf Addiction Official. I hope to hear your thoughts on today's topic. You can always find me and Casey on Twitter and Instagram. The links for everything I've mentioned are below in the show notes. If you enjoyed today's episode, please support this podcast by sharing it with some book nerd friends or on your favorite social media space. That would really help me out, and I appreciate you for doing so. The uncut video version of this podcast is available now on Patreon. Join us there for exclusive videos, including after shows and more. So if you're interested in that at all, you'll need to come on over to Patreon and sign up. Without further ado, let's get started. We've got a lot to talk about today, so we are going to get to it. Joining me is my feature co-host, Casey, from Heart Full of Ink. Welcome back, Casey.
Hello, hello. I'm so excited to be here.
Yay, I'm glad you're here, too, talking about our favorite thing. Woo!
Yay!
Here we are again. So today we are doing another installment of our re-re-read of the Mercy Thompson series.
Yes, just as many re's as you can put on there.
Exactly. So as we do, we're going to run down the stats and the synopsis, and then we'll jump in. So we're talking about Bloodbound, written by Patricia Briggs, published January 30th, 2007 by Ace and Penguin Audio. The paperback is 292 pages. The audiobook is 10 hours and 2 minutes, and it's narrated by Lorelei King. Casey, would you please share the synopsis?
I would be happy to. Under the rule of science, there are no witch burnings allowed, no water trials or public lynchings. In return, the average law-abiding solid citizen has little to worry about from the things that go bump in the night. Sometimes I wish I was an average citizen. Mechanic Mercy Thompson has friends in low places and in dark ones, and now she owes one of them a favor. Since she can shapeshift at will, she agrees to act as some extra muscle when her vampire friend Stefan goes to deliver a message to another of his kind. But this new vampire is hardly ordinary, and neither is the demon inside of him.
Dun, dun, dun. I really like this installment because it gets a lot darker, like dealing with the villain here. And
the villain is evil.
Yes, he is
creepy.
He's a sorcerer. Isn't that what they called him?
Mm-hmm.
He's a sorcerer who was turned into a vampire.
Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, he invited a demon to live inside of
him. Yes. Hey, come
on. And the demon is slowly taking over.
Yes. So he becomes, what did they call it? He was a demon rider, and then he turned demon ridden.
Mm-hmm.
So, because I guess you can't control the demon for very long.
Nope. It's gonna get you.
Yes. So, I'm sure he thought he was strong enough to manage it, but he was not.
Everybody thought they were strong enough to manage it, and no, they were not.
I know, it's like that conceitedness, like, you know, you just think you're better and you're stronger and you can do it, and then it's like, psych, no, you can't. Yes, and it was interesting, also, was all the relationship-y stuff,
lots of it. This one becomes like a convoluted rhombus-like thing.
Yes. It's not even like a triangle. It's like a triangle times two. I don't know. It's weird.
It's weird.
Maybe it is a rhombus. Maybe you're right. Like, it's kind of like just all over the place. But Mercy is getting kissed by three guys in this book.
She's kind of into two of them.
She definitely is into two of them. Definitely.
Yes.
And I think the third one, she, I think, was more shocked by it.
She was a little shocked, but it was also like, it was there. The writing was on the wall. She just didn't want to see it. She thought it was platonic, but no. No, he does not have platonic feelings for you.
Okay, so let's just jump to, like, the third one we're talking about, because I think this was the most unexpected and one that I rolled my eyes at the worst, because I feel like there is no way she was ever going to be with Stefan. No way.
Absolutely not. Like, she's already way too tangled up with Adam and Samuel. If neither one of them existed, I could easily see her hanging out with him and, like, maybe going on adventures in his mystery machine, but only if Adam didn't exist, only if Samuel was gone and living in Texas forever and never came back. Like, if it was just Stefan in this world, yes, they would be best friends and have fun together.
Yeah, I agree. I think that if it was just him, I think they was he would still be friend-zoned. She would not be with him. Like, for example, there's this one part toward the end. I didn't even mark it. I should have. Where, you know, after she kills Andre, she comes out. And, of course, she sees, what's his face? What's his name? The kid. Wolf. She sees Wolf. And then she turns around and Stefan's there. But she instantly looks down because she doesn't want to see his eyes look how they look when they're half dead, right?
Yeah, quote, unquote. Super gross, vampire-y dead eyes.
Like the milky dead eyes from when it's not nighttime.
Yes.
Like a few of them can get up before the sun sets and they just have this look about their eyes. And she didn't even want to look at him. So I'm like, well, there's no way you want to do anything with that. You can't even stand to look at him.
And I mean, even in the beginning of the book, when he was like, can I please sleep in your closet? And she's like, you're going to have a pillow and blanket. And he's like, I don't need that because I'm dead. And she's like, nope, you're not dead.
No,
you're having not a this pillow house, you're and not blanket. Dead.
And then she's like, now I can't sleep in here. I got to go because there's someone dead in there. Like, she can't get it out of her mind. So they were never, ever going to be it. And I almost wish a little bit that Patricia Briggs didn't go there with them. Like, can't she just have a really good friend? Like, I think I complained about this last time around. Probably, about Stefan's character.
Yeah.
Because I just don't think, like I said last, you know, episode, does she have to have all the guys after her? Do they all need to love her? It's just a little, just one too many. Like, leave Stefan in the friend zone on both sides.
Yeah. Yeah. But to be fair, Warren and Kyle aren't in love with her, so that's something.
Warren and Kyle are gay.
Sorry, I had to make the joke.
No, they don't want her. I mean, maybe one day if they get a little, they need some excitement and they're bored, maybe they might invite her, but they still won't want to be with her like that after.
No.
Like, thanks, they're Mercy, you can go home
platonic.
Now. Right. No. So, yeah. So that part, and I kind of wanted to know, so there's this one part in the book where, you know, Mercy drinks his blood. And I'm like, oh, for the love of God, you have to drink that blood. But he's whispering some things to her that we could not hear, that we weren't told. And I would have loved to know what he was saying to her.
She described it as loving words. And even, like, she was kind of half delusional at that point, kind of unconscious, very much in pain. And she was unsure of what she heard. So, but yeah, I would have liked to hear what exactly he was saying to her, because Adam and Samuel heard. They know.
They did. And they were pissed about it.
Oh, they were so mad.
Pissed off to the max. I'm like, well, I don't know. I guess he has no
Well, I guess they're allies at the moment, right? So they were able to not murder him when they were free.
Well, also, Bran showed up and was able to control them because he's the more dominant wolf. I think if Bran had not been there, Adam and Samuel might have killed Stefan. Like,
they would have high-fived each other later.
Yeah, like. They would have been like, Wild One eliminated. Mercy's safe again.
They would have had that enemy of my enemy is my friend type thing going on. We'll join forces and take him out. Then we'll go back to hating each other again.
Yes, exactly.
And it's funny. They don't even hate each other, really, but they just know they're competition for each other. So,
which Samuel's not really competition. Like, he.
Well, in he this, fucked we up know too much. That. But in this book, she, like, still clearly has some kind of feelings for him, even though she tries to remember why they're not together, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But she lets him kiss her. Yes. You know what I mean? I think he's kissed her a couple times so far.
He kisses her twice in the book.
Yeah.
She cuddles him a few times. Yes. Like, he needs that emotional support, and she gives it to him. So, yes, there is that bond there, but it's so much stronger with Adam. Like, it's not even a competition, even though it kind of is a competition. It really shouldn't be.
Yeah, I think it was really awesome that in this book, Adam finally let the cat out of the bag, so to speak. Like, he explained to her, like, he basically said, look, stop running from me. I know what you're doing. We're going to have this conversation. And she's like, no, I don't want to talk about it. And then she's like, well, I might. I did run around all the places with your phone number on my collar. So I must have wanted to talk to him. So she caves and they have this conversation. And it's like that whole, you could tell Mercy's issue is lack of, what is the word I'm looking for? Not freedom, but like,
agency over herself.
Agency over herself when she's around him.
Mm-hmm.
And she thinks he's doing it to her. And on she purpose. Resents that. Right, on purpose. And it's like this whole intricate puzzle to like unwind. Because she thinks it's very cut and dry. Like, why are you treating me like this? You're trying to alpha me. He's like, I'm not doing it on purpose. I try to turn it off, actually. Mm-hmm. But it's hard around you. So I'm like, ooh.
He also explained how it's harder when he's near Pack. When they're alone and far away from Pack, it's easier for him to turn off.
Yes.
And also, he reminded her that she has stood up to Bran for her entire freaking life. And so she doesn't submit when she doesn't want to submit. She is actually like letting her own walls down around Adam and letting him dominate her because she feels that sense of safety, because she feels that sense of connection, and that she wants that with him. And she just has to admit it to herself.
I can understand her confusion in that, because someone with a naturally dominant personality, when that happens, it's confusing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I normally don't act like this. I normally don't want this. You know what I mean? So she's very confused by it.
Oh, absolutely. And it's fun to watch her fall, but it's also a little annoying when she goes back and forth like this. Because, you know, she keeps saying that, yes, Adam claimed me in front of his pack, but I'm not a werewolf. But then she goes around dominating all the werewolves. She dominates Daryl, who's number two. She sends werewolves to Adam, who need help. She, you know, she does all this stuff that basically says, hey, I'm in charge.
I'm in charge.
Yes. I'm the co-alpha of this pack. Like, I'm doing all of these things, quote unquote, under Adam's name. Like, oh yeah, Adam won't mind if you do this. Adam won't mind if I do this. Adam won't mind. Bitch, you're doing it. Like, you're being alpha. Yeah. Nobody else would have the balls to say or do any of this.
100% she was acting like the alpha. She is like, she walked in that house and just started bossing everybody around.
She bossed it was like, Daryl around. She got yeah. Warren to sit down. She
came in and was like, Warren, lay down.
And he did instantly. Like, okay.
And then Daryl was like, shocked. Like, oh, I couldn't get him down.
Mm-hmm.
But you did.
Yep.
He was disgusted, I think. But
then when she was talking to the Stefan's menagerie, his humans that he feeds from, and they were like, hey, can you help us? Can the werewolves take over for us? Mercy has the audacity to say, no, I don't have that power. I can't help you. And I'm just like, excuse me, ma'am. What have you been doing for the last 4 chapters?
I know.
You've been running this pack yourself.
I know. But I think she means, like, at that point, obviously, she felt that Adam was alive, right? Mm-hmm. And compared to Adam, she doesn't. So maybe she was just trying to not impede on Adam's
space, I think so. But it was just, you know? It was one of those things where I was like, everything else you've done in this book says you are the alpha and you are in charge. And now that humans are asking you for help, you're saying no.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah.
That felt know. Really.
I can find out.
I mean, it's human of her to be that flip floppy, but I just really, I had to put that in the book and roll my eyes.
Mm-hmm. In the moment, she could have made a million promises, mm-hmm. and I think Adam would have went along with all of them because
Absolutely.
She was trying to get to him and free mm-hmm. him and stuff. So he probably would have honored whatever she promised to be.
Oh, absolutely.
Upfront.
And I think he would have honored it because he's a good man who would want to help these people. He wouldn't mm-hmm. want them to be slaughtered by the vampires. He would do what he can.
Absolutely. So, yeah, she took she could have just did the right thing there.
She could have. It was a bit much, but it shows her human side. That she's not mm-hmm. always in control, that she's not always thinking things through, that sometimes she just steps into the role of alpha and doesn't even really consciously realize that she's being the alpha in book mm-hmm. 2 of this series.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she was like totally the alpha of that pack. No one questioned her. No one, even when she came back later, you know, to speak to... who'd she come back later to speak to? Oh, I think it was Warren again. And Daryl was sitting in the chair.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, go get some food.
Yes.
Like, off, be off.
Yes.
He just does it and then comes back. You were right. That helped. I needed. Like, she just walks in. Everyone just steps aside, mm-hmm. pays no attention to her. Like, there is no pushback. Mm-hmm. No one is giving her pushback.
No. And the one werewolf who did, he was blocking the door and he was like, you're not allowed because you're not pack. And Honey came up and she's like, she's pack. Let her in.
Yeah.
The man, you know, later hits Honey because he's a misogynistic asshole. And so Mercy goes up and tells Daryl, go take care of this. Go put him in his place and don't let him hurt Honey. Again, controlling the pack.
Mm-hmm. That is wild, though, because I mean, you can tell already. And I think it was even I can't remember the exact line. But, you know, Honey would be so much higher than her rank mm-hmm. if she wasn't tied to her husband.
Oh, absolutely.
Like
yes.
So she's a strong wolf and it's like very dominant, too. So, mm-hmm. I mean, it takes some skill for her to just
submit.
Not dominant when people like do that kind of thing to her, because I'm sure she would have, like, loved to drag his ass across the floor.
Mm-hmm.
At least try to, but she didn't.
Adam says she fights dirty, so if she had the chance, ooh, she would have taken that man out.
He better not turn his back. She might get him later. But that's Honey, though. I mean, she's also kind of the one you kind of love to hate, at least me anyway. She's very finicky when it comes to Mercy.
I think we all love to hate her at first, but she grows throughout the series. And I don't want to spoil things because I know there are some readers who haven't read it. But in the next few books or so, I really love Honey. I love her personality. I love her characteristics. Like, I love Honey. Right now, mm-hmm. in Bloodbound, Yeah, no, she's kind of a bitch.
She kind of is. She's like coming to the shop with like white pants on, and she's like just being the absolute most in everything. Mm-hmm. It's like, ooh, you're a pain in the you know what. She even begs Adam to please anyone, not her. She doesn't fit here, mm-hmm. you know.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Oh wow.
But that's why he sent her. He's yeah. like, she'll take care of business.
Mm-hmm. She'll I listen made the to right you. Choice. She'll fight dirty. She's a strong mm-hmm. fighter. She'll get along with you. She might sass, but Mercy needs sass. She needs somebody to, you know, bicker with. So
yeah, I'm surprised they're not besties, honestly. I mean, they should be.
They should be. They have basically the same personality. They're just be, a little yes. bit different with their clothing options.
Exactly. I'm like, can you imagine Mercy, like, in her whatever getup she's wearing? Greasy hands, mm-hmm. messy hair, and here's Honey, prim and proper. Mm-hmm. Super sharp outfit, very clean. Them two standing next to each other when old boy came in must have been a sight.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Honestly, I forgot about Mr. Black in this story. And I don't think he ever comes up again. Like, I don't think he and his daughter are mentioned in the Alpha and Omega series. And I don't think there's anything that describes what happens to her.
No, not that I can remember. So she obviously just goes off to Brand's pack mm-hmm. and that's it. She's just over there somewhere.
Yeah. And thankfully he heals her and helps her and everything is good mm-hmm. and happy. Yay.
Yay. We get one really happy situation, which yes. I like, you yes. know, at least one.
But it was really, truly disturbing. Like Mercy said, that out of the 150 alphas in North America, Bran only gave a list of 15 who he would trust a 13-year-old girl with.
Yeah.
And that's just horrifying. Yeah.
Yeah, it says a lot about their community, about how a lot of them are, like, stuck in the past with how things used to be.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes me wonder, like, these wolves aren't, well, they're like every race. You got some good ones and some bad ones. You got good fae, bad fae, good vamps, bad vamps, mm-hmm. and same with wolves.
Mm-hmm. And humans, too. Good humans, and bad humans. But right. It's horrifying. Because the alphas are in charge of everything. And you get a little taste of that from Anna's perspective in the Alpha and Omega series. But, mm-hmm. Yeah, it's... Werewolves aren't all good. We should be very, no. very happy that Adam is living next door to Mercy. And he's one of the good ones.
I mean, because that could have been a way... awful situation mm-hmm. if someone else was watching her
there wouldn't be a story. She'd be off no. with Stefan solving mysteries in the mystery machine.
I know, which actually I wouldn't hate if there was like a side book of that, like maybe mm-hmm. she just goes off with him for one adventure and then they're friends though, you know.
I think that kind of happens in a later book, but I don't want to spoil anything, so I will zip yeah. my lips.
That's right. How I forget things. It's weird.
It's really funny. So this is just a funny side note for me. The scene where Mercy is in Uncle Mike's pub and she has to sing for everybody. I remember mm-hmm. that scene vividly, but I thought it happened in the next book, in Iron Kissed.
Oh, like, really?
I don't know. I think about that scene every once in a while because it's one of the funnier scenes of the whole series. But I was always convinced that it was in Iron Kissed because that's the Fae book. And so mm-hmm. I'm reading this and it starts happening. And I was like, wait, no, this happens in the next book. What's Wrong going book. On? And I have to look at the cover. I'm like, it's still Bloodbound. It's not.
Yeah.
Yeah. It all gets confusing after a while.
And by chance, if you listen to the audiobook, that scene, mm-hmm. Lorelai King, she actually has a pretty decent singing voice. So
ooh, I might have to go listen like just to hear that.
Yeah, so that was fun. I did like that scene a lot. There were you know, she got a lot of cooperation from a lot of people in this book to make this end result happen.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Especially from the vampires, which we kind of knew were coming, but the Fae, the Fae really helped her out. And the humans, her cop friend, Tony.
Yeah.
He helped a lot more.
He did. And I think this is just the beginning of a great friendship between he and the wolves and stuff, because he really, like, helped Samuel out. Like, you know, he was gone. And then he come back looking like crazy person. Like, what is happening? And they're like, you know, if the hospital starts asking questions, this might not be good. So he says, yeah, just tell them it was a police matter. Give them my card. He's like, you know,
he's a good guy, and he's not in love with Mercy, which is good.
Thank God for once, right? For once.
Yeah. No, he's in love with somebody else. So,
yes. Okay. I think this is a great time to take a break. Check out the commercials by listening to those. You're supporting the podcast. And also, while you're at it, hop on over to Amazon and check out the book review journal. It's available right now, and the link is in the show notes. So when we come back, we will finish our discussion of Bloodbound. Stay with us. Today's episode is brought to you by the Shelf Addiction merch store. Check out all the bookish t-shirts, notebooks, mugs, and more. Don't miss out on these original designs, perfect for any book nerd. Support the podcast and visit shelfaddiction.com/merch and pick up your next favorite bookish item. All right, welcome back, guys. We're going to continue talking about book two in the Mercy Thompson series. Yay. What else should we cover in this book? There's a lot going on.
For as fast as it started, like it starts insanely fast on page one, just going. It drags out in a few areas where we skip, like, oh, it's been 2 weeks since this happened. Oh, it's been another 2 weeks since this event happened. And the events in between are very freaking scary, but it lasts a while.
Yeah, it does. I didn't even count the weeks. Maybe, because I know at the end there for sure, wasn't it like 2 or 3 weeks after she killed what's-his-face before Stefan came back around or whatever?
Yeah, no, it's like over a month passed, possibly 2 months in this book. And yeah, it's
that's
just
a long time, because while she was looking for Andre, I had a bad sense of how long it was. So I know she'd been out looking for a while by the time Adam caught up with her for the third time that she got called. He got called about her.
That had been a couple weeks, and then they went on their date, and they were super cute together.
Oh.
You know they're cute.
They are. They are. I can't even, like, lie about it. They're very cute.
And then it was, like, another week or 2 weeks before she found Andre.
And she was looking diligently, and then she happens upon Andre by mistake, really. Like, so she had already found the woman who was off on her own. And then she was doing something with a car, you know, out driving this car. And then it broke down or something. Something happened. She had to get out. And then she saw all the ghosts.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, my God. You know? So, obviously, she can see ghosts. And the ghosts are, that means he killed a lot of people.
Yeah. There's a lot of ghosts in this book, which I thought was really interesting. Because usually paranormals with vampires and werewolves, you don't talk about the dead. Like, people die, but you never mention the ghost or the afterlife or what happens next. And nope, the ghosts are kind of what save the day, because they're the ones that are like, hey, here we are.
Exactly.
She accidentally discovered Wolf's house first, which is really creepy. And he,
but there was no one in there, though. It was just him.
He had somebody whimpering in the bathroom.
Oh, God, that's right.
So, yeah.
So he might have had one person in there?
Yeah.
Maybe more. Maybe they were just asleep, I guess.
But there were a couple of ghosts who wanted Wolf to die, and they were trying to encourage Mercy to kill him. But she's too stubborn, I guess. She's like,
she's arguing with them.
Kill him. Like,
I just can't kill him for no reason.
There needs to be a reason, she said. There are reasons in later books, but, you know, for right now, it's okay. She won't kill him.
And then we get a surprise, though. So Wolf is in his state. He hasn't moved, but she can hear him talking to her. Mm-hmm. So,
and then he kind of gets up and crawls out. He stays in the shadows, but oh god, he's crawling like a freaking lizard. And I was like, oh,
I don't blame her. Nope. I would have ran right to where the light shines in. You can't come in this circle, buddy. It's light right here. Stay back. Be crazy. Mm-hmm. But you know, he told her, he's like, oh, well, you know, if you were to kill Andre, I wouldn't tell. Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't. He actually helps her with Andre in the sense that he comes and he kills the menagerie people and then they set the house on fire and then they tell their mistress that, nope, it was just the humans, not Mercy.
Yes.
You're safe from the walker.
Right. And the wolves weren't involved, mm-hmm. and they swear up and down it was the two humans they killed. Which is another conversation in itself, because Mercy blames Stefan, even though he didn't actually, they didn't die at his hand, right?
Right.
Because he felt like Mercy would not forgive him if he killed those people. Mm-hmm. So Wolf does it, but she's still mad at him about it. So,
I kind of understand where she's coming from, because she wants to save every single person she can possibly save. But I don't think these two people could have been saved. Like, they had been chewed on. They looked like death warmed over. They looked terrible.
Their mental state was messed up.
Even if
they couldn't have kept a secret. Mm-hmm.
Even if Stefan,
and Wolf said it.
Yeah, no. It would not have worked out for them. Like, they would have suffered any which way.
And they cannot go around saying vampires and all this stuff. And yeah, they were just kind of, and I understood the vampire's point of view on this too. They were too far gone.
Mm-hmm.
And plus they needed a scapegoat.
Yeah.
So, yeah, what are you going to do? You know, from the vampire point of view, that was the right thing to do.
And I agree with them.
Putting them out of their misery, kind of, right?
Like a mercy killing.
Yeah.
Not to call it mercy, but it was a mercy killing for them. Like they got their peace. And they got their vengeance. Andre was murdered. Like, they can move on to the next afterlife and be happy and know that he's not killing more people.
Yeah. So I don't quite understand why Mercy was so upset about it.
Well, she just murdered somebody basically in cold blood. And she was so upset by that I think it was kind of like a overflow of that emotional state for her.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If she has time to sit down and actually think about it and, you know, think about how these humans had suffered and that it was, you know, better for them in the long run, I think she'll get over it. But it's still, you shouldn't be mad about him for this.
No, I mean, he did what he could do. Mm-hmm. And he brought back the charms that you left there. So, I don't know. You just need to let it go. Let it go.
Yeah. It's okay. It's fine. Like,
because honestly, there wasn't anything else that could be done. What did she want? What did she hope that could be done? It didn't make sense. Like, she knows, she's told people, you can't. She's told what's his face at the shop, the kid, you can't let anybody know that you know about vampires. Mm-hmm. You can't even let Stefan know that you know about him. Mm-hmm. This is dangerous. It's
very dangerous. And
she knows this.
Yep. She even told the cop, there's stuff out there that you cannot know about, and I cannot tell you about it. Just know that there is more stuff out there and be wary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so good for him. He took the leap of faith and did that, because a lot of people would just keep grilling her with questions like, no, what is this? Mm-hmm. I can't just... But also, at that same time, you live in a world where they are real.
Yep.
So if fae are real, and a whole lot of fucking things can be real.
Oh, yeah. If the fae have come out and now werewolves are coming out, mm-hmm. I'd be really nervous. I'd be like, what else is out there? Are there vampires out there? Are there demons out there? And the answer is yes. And they're here and they're killing. I'd be like,
are there zombies mm-hmm. out there? All the fantasy things that you think are just fiction, I'd be asking, are all of these real?
Mm-hmm. Are they here? Are they coming to kill us? Is it like, mm-hmm. are humans now on the meat market? Like,
yeah, like we're the bottom of the food chain. Strength wise, it's true.
Mm-hmm.
Humans are so fragile. I mean, even Stefan was telling Mercy, like, her human self was so fragile. Like, you know, when she breaks something, she has to go get a cast. She won't just heal like the wolves. So
she heals faster than a human. But yeah, no, she still has to get a cast on her ankle, and mm-hmm. her dislocated shoulder hurts for a few weeks. Yeah. So, yeah.
Mm. And just think of regular old us without any other kind of paranormal anything going on. Yeah, so
humans are fragile. Humans will die very easily.
Mm-hmm. Although the wolves do have a reason to protect the humans because they want to get with human people to try to mm-hmm. procreate and stuff. So
do you want to talk about that real fast?
Yeah, sure.
What did you think of Samuel's past in Texas?
Oh, gosh. Okay. So this is a tricky. This is tricky. Mm-hmm.
It's a hard conversation, and I don't think there's any right answer.
No. So, you guys, just so you know, Samuel was with this woman. He human after woman. Mercy ran away, he went found a human woman while he was in med school for the gazillion time. I don't know, second time, whatever. And they got together. She gets pregnant, and then she doesn't want the baby, so she just didn't have the baby and did not discuss it with him. Mm-hmm. She just took care of it. So he was very hurt by that, and it kind of scarred him mm-hmm. in a way. And I think that sucks. You know, it sucks that they didn't at least have a conversation, right? Mm-hmm. But
but it's a woman's choice.
Right.
And
right.
I fully respect her choice. And yes. also, human women usually cannot carry a werewolf baby. Like, baby,
right.
They miscarry more often than not. Like, Adam's ex-wife, she had 7 miscarriages, and Jesse was the only baby who survived out of 8 pregnancies. Right. Like, there's just something about the DNA that doesn't quite fit with humans. So they talk about this a little bit more in Alpha and Omega because you get Charles' history. But basically, you can procreate with a human. It's just not very likely to succeed. So even if she hadn't done what she did, the likelihood of the baby surviving to term is very minuscule. Like, it probably would not have survived.
Which is hard, which, you know, kind of reverts back to why Mercy is so
wanted.
What's the word? Like, wanted, and like why she's so valuable, mm-hmm. right? Because she has the abilities, because she can transform herself. Like, there's some magic there.
Because mm-hmm. she can.
That just makes. Yeah.
Yeah. And Charles' mother used magic to keep her from transforming for 9 months. And so that's mm-hmm. why Charles is the only born werewolf in the world.
Yeah. So, I mean, I do feel bad for Samuel. I understand his plight, mm-hmm. but I also understand life is life, right? Mm-hmm. It's not your choice in everything. Mm-hmm. So while it sucked for you, she had to do what she had to do, mm-hmm. and you need to get some therapy and carry on.
Yeah.
That's what you need to do.
Yeah. No,
because he's still carrying that load. It hasn't relieved, because otherwise it wouldn't have been able to affect him, like that whole accident that he had to treat. It wouldn't have, if he had gotten over that or gotten through it, mm-hmm. that wouldn't have affected him in that way.
Also, the demon was living like half a mile away from him, or from the hospital. So he was feeling the effects of the demon anger and issues. So that was kind of eroding at his control a little bit as well, as Mercy points out towards the end. But that could just be, you know, like the icing on top of the cake, because Samuel has been losing control. He hasn't felt normal in the last 15 years. He's, you know, he's had a lot of issues.
Yeah, but you can tell. Okay, so yes, two things. So one, yes, the demon has been affecting him for a lot longer than everyone else. Mm-hmm. He's been working there every day with that influence. But second, like when, for example, the demon had affected other wolves, they just got angry and mad and all these other mm-hmm. things. For him, he was trying to imply he might off himself. You know what I'm saying? Like, this was affecting him differently, mm-hmm. I think, because of his internal things yes. that he hadn't dealt with.
Yes.
Otherwise, he might just have been angry.
Yes, absolutely.
Or
yes.
something else. So still, I think he needed to work through those things once and for all. And he's not going to do that being around Mercy. He needs to leave.
He does need to leave, because Mercy is still that pie in the sky hope for him that, mm-hmm. yes, I do care about you as a person. Yes, I fucked up and I wanted to make you mine when you were 15. And that was wrong of me. Thank God he apologized, so I can kind of forgive him for that. But I'm still...
Right.
No, but he still wants kids. Like, that's his one goal in life, is to have kids. And that's, yeah, like, it's not the only reason he wants Mercy, but it is a solid reason. It is a majority of the reason.
Yeah, I think his wolf wants Mercy for more than that, I think.
Yeah, no, like, they've made it, that, and they're friends, and he really cares about her. But yeah. She can offer him children the way any other werewolf could not, the way a human woman can't really. Like, even if the baby survives birth, he only has a few decades with them, because they may want to try and change into a werewolf and that would fail. Mm-hmm. Or they might just die of old age. Like, mm-hmm. he's going to keep having and losing children.
Yeah. It's a reality, and he needs to, I guess, deal with and accept the fact that he may not have the life or the, you know, he may not get what he thinks he wants.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, sorry, Samuel, I feel bad for you, dude, but.
I feel bad for him, too, but he can't just make Mercy his because of babies. Like, that's not how this works.
No, and it's so weird. Like, you know, he's living in her house or her trailer, mm-hmm. and, you know, he's like, oh, you going to movies? You know, and then he's like kissing her and stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh my God, this is so weird.
He's staking so his claim, and it's not, he needs to move on. Like, I know Bran sent him here so he could feel alive, but it's not healthy for anybody. Not for him. No. Not for Mercy. Not for Adam.
And how can Mercy move on? Like, she, in her mind, she knows that she doesn't want to be with Samuel. She knows this in her brain. Mm-hmm. You know, her common sense tells her. Mm-hmm. But there's some other feelings that have, like, lingered, which is making this a problem. And she can't move on totally with him there.
Yeah.
He needs to be gone.
He needs to be gone.
Because, you know, have you ever, and I think maybe a majority of us have had that one relationship that you always remember, mm-hmm. right? That was Samuel for yes. her.
Like, he was her first love. Forward. He was her first protector. Right. He was, you know, when you're 15 and 16 and you're in love at that point.
Yes.
And so, yeah. Yes, she always has those soft feelings for him. And no, they didn't really get closure, because they were supposed to run away and get married together. But then Bran said he just wants babies. And so Mercy ran away. She didn't talk to him. She didn't, you know, confront him. They didn't hash it out or fight it out or whatever. Not until Moon called. And now he's living with her. And she's like, we're friends, but that door's still open. We didn't, you know, fight it out.
It needs to be shut, firmly shut. Regardless of Adam, I feel like regardless of him.
Yeah, for
that just was never, it's not meant to be. So really, ultimately, that leaves her with one choice and one choice only, and that is Adam.
It's been Adam since day one. Like, I've loved Adam since the beginning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I felt like there's never been any competition for him. Not really. When you break it down, all these different variables.
There's no competition.
It's a clear answer.
Mm-hmm. She
and I think
she calls him. She wears his phone number on her collar. Mm-hmm. She could have anybody else's phone number. She could put Warren's phone number on there. She could put Daryl's or Samuel's if she wanted. But no, she wants Adam to come get her.
Yes. Because she trusts him.
And she loves him.
And she likes him. Well, she likes him now. She probably loves him too, but she's not willing to admit it.
She won't admit it yet, but it's there.
Yeah. Like the scene in the gym. They're like getting hot and heavy. Okay, first they're fighting, right? Yeah. They're doing like these kicks and moves and stuff.
And
Aikido, they're tumbling and fighting.
Taekwondo. Aikido. And all of that.
And then before you know it, somebody's on top of someone and some things are happening. And then here comes Jesse. Hey, guys. Hey, what's up? Oh, what did I walk in on?
He was giving her a back massage that started out really professional. And then he was like going under the clothes and he's holding her hair and touching her butt. And then Jesse walks in.
That's no massage I've ever seen. Not a real one anyway. No, not a legit massage.
That's the massage that you end up pregnant from. You. Like,
exactly. And of course, you know, Mercy jumps up basically like, oh, thanks. That was getting out of control. So thank you, Jesse.
Yeah, thanks, Jesse. I need to run out of here as fast as possible.
He's like, woo, that was out of control then, but it was going to happen if she hadn't been interrupted.
Mm-hmm. It was going to get much, much hotter than that.
Mm-hmm. But. Yeah, that was hilarious. Yes. Oh, my God.
Yes.
All those scenes between them, it's really cute.
It's slowly building that tension up, and it's amping it up. And, you know, the next book, we get some more good stuff in the next book and the next book. And I love Mercy and Adam together. I really do. And I love seeing these early scenes where they're still, you know, looking at each other. Like, do I trust this? Do I want this?
And also it's believable. It's like, okay, so, you know, it's not one of those faded things, right? It's not faded. It's not like insta love. It's not insta love.
Not at all. It's been so many years of antagonizing each other.
Exactly. And it's like this slow progress. Mm-hmm. But not so slow that it's infuriating for us to read. You know how sometimes it's so slow, it's like you want to pull your hair out. It's so slow. Not this case. I think the pacing is pretty good. And I actually can't remember what book it actually becomes official. I cannot remember which book.
There's some stuff that actually happens in the next two books, and I don't remember the exact order of things.
Yeah.
But basically, like, it happens fairly quickly in this series, comparatively.
Being that we are now at book 13, and this is book 2. Yeah. So it happens at least in the first four books, right?
Yeah.
At least. Yeah. Worst case for book 4, I think. I don't know.
And it's fast and easy for us. But if you look at like the whole span of their entire relationship, he's been living next door to Mercy for like 7 or 8 years now. They finally go on their first date back in December of last year. And then she ignores him for another 6 months. So, you know, if we were living this on a day to day, it would be really long and exhausting and drawn out. But because we're getting the fiction, you know, where we can jump forward 2 weeks and another 2 weeks and another 2 weeks and let's jump forward 6 months here. Like, it's much
but
faster.
But also, don't forget, to be fair, Adam was married.
This is true.
She knew his wife. Mm-hmm. You know, she lived there in that house. Mm-hmm. So he wasn't single the whole time they were neighbors.
Not the whole time, but she divorced him a few years. Because Jesse was less than 10 when her mother moved out, I think. Or maybe
around
10. I don't
know. The timing is kind of funny, but I feel like it wasn't like she was there for a second and left.
No, Mercy knew her for a couple while. Years.
Right.
So like 3 or 4 years?
Obviously.
Like, yeah, no, there was some time where, nothing would ever possibly happen. But,
right,
you know.
Which I like, mm-hmm. because it's like, it's real, like, real. That's how stuff happens with people sometimes. And it's not this stupid fantastical. And, you know, I don't hate the faded maid trope. Mm-hmm. I don't mind it. But it's refreshing when something is, like, more
nuanced.
Yes, exactly. Or even just generic, right? Mm-hmm. Like, not generic, but authentic.
Realistic.
That's the right word. When it's more authentic. And it's not like, oh, we're meant to be, so that's it.
It's not we're locking eyes across the room and suddenly in love and getting married. And no, they're...
Or you smell a scent and suddenly that's your person. This is a lot more to it.
Yes.
And I appreciate that. I think it makes us like them more as a couple because they have to work for it.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they do. They do work for it. And they work hard on this relationship. Like, throughout the entire series, their relationship isn't easy. They butt heads, they fight together, but they talk through it. Like in this book, where Adam is like, we need to have this conversation. You're stuck in the car with me, so let's talk. It's going to be uncomfortable, but we need to talk. And they do that mm-hmm. over and over and over again. And I know they keep saying, oh, Adam is, you know, a man of his time. He was raised in the 1950s. This is who he is. Adam is a lot more than just a man who was raised in the 1950s. He's very considerate. Yeah. He's basically a feminist. He, you know, Honey would be much higher in her ranking if she wasn't married to the submissive. And I think Adam would put her at number 4 if he could.
Mm-hmm.
So
he would.
Absolutely. He trusts and respects her. And that was the other thing, is Mercy says, Adam respects me, when nobody else in the world, not even Samuel, respects me. But Adam does.
Yeah.
And that cemented it more than anything else in this book.
Yeah. And she respects him mm-hmm. because she knows that he's going to do the right thing. Mm-hmm. And she says that in the book too. Mm-hmm. Like, Adam would never have killed some people like this.
Nope. And I don't think he would have. I think he would have tried to find a way to help them. But after a few months, if he realized that there was no help for them, he might have killed them out of mercy.
Right.
But
he would have given them a chance. Mm-hmm. He would have tried something other than just slaughtering them.
Yeah.
But I don't know. So there's a lot of things about him that Mercy respects and likes. And plus, he's kind of hot to her, you know.
He's really hot.
Yes. So all the reasons. Yeah. So. Yeah. And it's always nice to have a built in stepchild so you don't have to worry about having any. You know, done. I didn't have to do any work.
Yes.
Okay, that was a good one. Do you think there's anything else before we...
I think we've
wrapped it up.
I mean, I can keep talking about Mercy forever because I love her, but, you know, you guys don't want to listen to me rant forever.
If you guys want to hear more of this chitter chat, come back or join us on YouTube when we do live reading sprints.
Yes.
And we talk about the things in the book that we're reading, and we might talk more about Mercy and Adam, obviously. So the next book is
Iron Kissed.
It's going to be a fun time. Mm-hmm. So obviously it's her turn to help the Fays now.
Because they helped her. So now
exactly,
they need her help.
Now she owes someone else a favor. And they did give her a lot of help.
They gave her a lot of help.
They gave her a whole kit of help. Mm-hmm. Here, take this kit and go off and kill vamps. There you go. And she did it. Yay, she did it.
She saved the world. Like, once again, Adam and Samuel were captured and Mercy came in and saved the day.
Of course. Of course. She's always going to be saving people she loves. Mm-hmm. Always.
Always.
Okay, so that's it for today, you guys. Hope you enjoyed today's episode. And will join us for many more. So be sure to subscribe on whatever app you're listening to and hit the like button before you leave. We appreciate that. And we'll catch you guys in the next episode. All right. Take care of yourselves.
Bye, everybody. Bye, guys.
If you enjoyed today's episode and would like to show your support, there are a few things you can do. Head on over to Apple Podcasts and leave a positive 5-star review, or like this episode on your favorite podcast player. It seems so simple, but it really helps me out. You can share this podcast with other book nerd friends or on your favorite social media space. You can also join the Shelf Addiction Patreon family. For as little as $2 a month, you will help us produce even more awesome content for your ears. You can also consider joining the Shelf Addiction official Facebook group, where we talk all things bookish and more in a safe space. The Shelf Addiction podcast is a part of the Nerdy Maven Network. You can also reach us via email at info@shelfaddiction.com. Thank you for listening.